Just a reminder that Sunday evening of next week, we have our Fall Harvest Festival, and we are looking forward to it, rain or shine. Evidently, the weatherman seems to think it's going to be rain, but we're going to keep our fingers crossed. The only thing the rain would not allow us to do is to do the bounce houses. So otherwise, we're going to have corn dogs. I think we might have some little peanuts for sale. We're going to have plenty of games, plenty of good times together, and to enjoy each other's fellowship. So we look forward to you coming. We have one game left that's not taken. So instead of decorating a trunk, what we're going to do is you would come and just play a little game with the kids and hand them candy. Basically what you were doing at your trunk, just a lot more interactive. So we've got one more spot open if you're not signed up, and we'd love to have you. And we're really excited about it. Invite your friends, invite your neighbors. Don't steal them from another church, but you know, if you steal them for one night, I think the Lord might be okay with that. But it's just going to be a great time of fun and fellowship with our families all together. So we encourage you to come out next Sunday. Thank you so much. Oh, and if you would like to bring bags of candy, we'll still take them tonight and Wednesday night. You can leave them in the foyer. And we'll be glad for the donation. And if not, I will make sure we've got enough candy. No one will leave without their sweet tooth being satisfied. Thank y'all.
And also, before we get into today's worship service, I just wanted to read a verse from 1 Samuel 15, verse 22. It says, "But Samuel replied, 'What is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifices, or your obedience to his voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering the fat of rams.'" So we'll go into today's service. Before I even get to preach and get into worship, I just want you to think about today, about your obedience in today's service. Now, and we'll get into it a little bit later too, but just, are you here to sacrifice your time? Because I've had a rough week. Other people have had rough weeks. I'm here in obedience to what God has called us to be. So I just ask us as a church, as a whole, as a body, to be in obedience in today's service.
Just a quick missions announcement. We are going to be going to the Charlotte Processing Center on Thursday, December the 1st, from 2 to 6. I have 20 slots open. So I have about maybe 4 or 5 that's already filled. If you want to go, it's first come, first serve. So just see me if you want to go help on Thursday, December the 1st from 2 to 6 at the Charlotte Processing Center. Those of you who have went, can tell you we always have a good time, so just let me know. We will be getting out the shoe boxes in this next week or two. But next Sunday morning, we are taking up a special offering for the shipping and the shoe boxes. Okay, the shipping has gone up to $10, so just make sure you bring a little extra offering next Sunday, and we'll get that postmarked, and our goal is at least $500. We'll at least get 50 boxes sent. If the Lord doubles that, we'll send our 100, but we're just asking for 50, and $500 is what we need to get those 50 shoe boxes sent, so thank you so much.
I do have a couple of announcements for the youth group. First off, November 6th, we will be having our chili cook-off. But not only are we having a chili cook-off, but we're also going to be doing a cookie competition to see who makes the best cookies. So we've already got the awards for all that. So please come out and support us. It will be by donation only. It'll start at 6 o'clock that evening. Also, Settler Time is here. But they have changed a lot of the stuff as far as registration. We used to be able, you know, to print off all of the forms and all. Well, everything has to be done online now. We cannot print anything off. So, not this Wednesday, but the next, we will be having a registration night for a settlement. So you can come and register for them before or after service. We'll stay here and we'll get those done. We just want to try and get everything done as easy as possible. But I will remind y'all again about that next week. And also, for the youth, we have a Halloween party this coming Friday in the Fellowship Building from 6 to 9. Please come out. Please invite your friends. And we're looking forward to seeing all of you. Could we stand to go to a word of prayer this morning? I want to add on what Ben said this morning. You know, A lot of us have had rough weeks this week, but it's great to be in the house of the Lord this morning.
Amen.
This is the place that you need to be when you have those rough weeks. But even if you're not having a rough week, I'm still glad to see that you're here, you're worshiping Him this morning. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I just want to thank You for allowing us to be in Your house this morning. Father, I pray that we will receive the blessings that we need to receive this morning, oh God. Father, I pray that if we have something going on, if we haven't gotten to know You the way that we should, Father, I pray that we will understand that these altars are open at any time. I pray that we will receive something that we can use to glorify Your name, oh God. I pray that we will get something today that we can share with others. Because it says that we're supposed to share Your word. We're supposed to share Your goodness with others. So I pray that we can share that and we can plant that seed and maybe they will allow it to prosper. I pray over the service this morning. I pray over the word we received this morning. In Your loving name we do pray. Amen.
Praise God. Amen. Praise God. How great it is to be in God's presence. I'm glad for obedience. Of course, it's all hail King Jesus. Let's give Him honor and praise this morning.
glad for that this morning. Wave out of stuff here. We see you smiling faces. You wave out of choir. Hallelujah. Choir, you wave back at them. Let's thank you. We send it out. Y'all send it back.
Amen.
God sends the blessings down. Amen. Our brethren, then let's be seated in God's presence. Stand again in God's presence. I'm so thankful that God says, where I am, you can be. He's where I know everywhere that He is holy. And this is holy ground this morning. This will be obedient. We've been already challenged. Be obedient to what the Spirit wants to do. Holy ground.
Oh,
means that, God, we're worshiping you, surrendering to you, but it also means we're giving to you. Dear Heavenly Father, we're giving you who we are, and we're giving you what we have. Now, all you've asked for in this moment is an offering, and dear God, our tithe unto you. That's what you've asked for, dear God. You didn't ask for it all, though you have rights to it all. So, Father, in obedience, we give you what's on our hearts. There's nobody that's forced to. There's nobody that's lesser because they don't. But, dear God, we are asked to worship you through the things that we give. So, Father, I pray as you have blessed us, dear Father, may we give that back to you. As we have been blessed and upraised and given things, dear God, beyond our worthiness, that, dear Father, we will show you that by giving to you. Lord, thank you. This is my praise. It's not just words. It is my actions. It is my giving. It is what I have. I give to you for your use. So bless this, dear God. Minister to people with it. Uplift the kingdom of God, both those outside of it and inside of it, because, dear God, we want to build up the church, but we want to increase the church by loving the world as well. So, Father, do your work, but don't do it around us, God. Do it through us, I pray. And bless the gifts that are given this day in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Linda testified to it just last week about
how it's not always easy to go to church. It's not always to go before our body to see each other and to find the strength. But like I said, it's kind of funny today how God has worked things out and ordained things. First Samuel 16, 10 through 13. In the same way, all seven of Jesse's sons were presented to Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Then Samuel asked, "Are these all your sons you have?" "They're still the youngest," Jesse replied, "but he is in the fields watching over the sheep and goats." "Send for him at once," Samuel said. "We will not sit down and eat until he arrives." So Jesse sent for his son. He was dark, handsome, with beautiful eyes. And the Lord said, "This is the one. Anoint him." So David stood there among his brothers. Samuel took the flask of oil he had brought with him and anointed David with the oil. And the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on. Yes. And Samuel returned to Ramah. But so getting into this message, as you see, there's seven up here. Kind of a backstory on where this all comes from today is the song, same God talks about, kind of, it's real similar to the song that was just sung. But in there it talks about the same God that made David courageous.
Yeah.
The same God that's then is now.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you felt him this morning, but he's here. And you can feel his power. So the song was being played at camp, and I was in a conversation with someone, and they were asking about it, and I said, "Well, there was a verse or a group of lyrics in there that really stood out, and it was the ones about David making a shepherd boy courageous." So I started to find myself in David, and it's kind of funny because I've always been a kind of a Samson kind of guy, but starting to see myself in David here is a little bit different than what I'm used to. See, I'm kind of doing something I like to do, but also don't like to do. I like to look into these stories that are taught so much throughout church. And you hear it from Sunday school, you hear it all the time about David and Goliath, David and Goliath, David and Goliath. But you don't see a whole lot of his backstory, and it's kind of hard for the kids to understand that. So I'm bringing it to you today, hopefully from an adult perspective. And somehow we can apply it to our lives today.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, I started to see myself in David and making a shepherd boy courageous. And see, I find myself in that because for me to be up here, this is me being courageous. This isn't who I've always been. And as I started to see myself in David,
yeah.
It's not something that I boast about. It's not something I go and I try to tell people about how God is working in my life and how he's making me courageous. And we was at ordination. And I was about to walk out the door, and this woman who had been taking pictures, she asked me what my name was, and she said, "You remind me of David."
Yeah.
I don't know this woman, still don't know her. But, so like I said, the way God works things is just the way he is and who he is, and the way he speaks and talks to us. Well, you see now, there's seven figures up here, hopefully if I count it right. Yeah, there's seven. There's seven, because there's one more that's missing. He's out in the fields and he's working. They have to go and get him. He was forgotten about. They knew that that they was going to be there. They knew that they were having
supper that night, and know that they had somebody coming in from town. They didn't know exactly the reason, so they had to send for David. You see something different about David here. He's a lot smaller than his brothers. And when he was chosen, when he was out in the fields, he was still smaller than all his brothers. He was the youngest. But there was more for him than just the field. So he comes in that night. They had waited on him out of respect because the one who brought the oil knew exactly what was going to happen. So they're there. They're coming to eat supper. And David walks in. And God said, "This is him. This is one I have chosen. Anoint him." Amen. You think David knew that night? Why me? You think David ate supper that night and knew exactly that one day he was going to become king, knew that one day he was going to kill a Goliath? That he was going to stand before an army that was shivering? No, he didn't know that. He just knew that he was a shepherd boy who got called in out of his fields and got called to come in for supper. What was special about David? What was special about David? He was chosen. So as we move on from David being chosen. You know, and this is kind of where I find myself with David once again. I know that God has called me. I know that God wants to use me. I'm in this area between my calling and being where God has called me to be. And I've started to wonder, how many times did David see himself in that? How many times did David think, "I know that I was anointed in front of all my brothers, in front of my family. I'm trying to live for you. But yeah, I just don't know where my calling is. I don't know where I'm going to end up." But you see, if it was up to David to choose where he was going to go, he'd still be in the shepherd fields. He'd still be a shepherd boy. And the question from the conversation that I was having about the song would come up. Now, I told this person I was kind of starting to see myself in David. They said, "Why?" Because he didn't just do it for David. See, they were directing the question towards me. But I seen the question as something different. God didn't choose and anoint David just for David. There was a future for him. Had nothing to do with his brothers. It was his future. It was his calling. One day he was going to have to be obedient. So in the meantime, here comes this man. We all know who that is, right? I can't think of David without thinking of Goliath. It's just been ingrained in me throughout growing up in church. But you see, what was Goliath? He was a warrior. The Bible says that from a child he was a trained, skilled warrior. He was even bigger than all of David's bigger brothers, older brothers. So much so that David's brothers had been out on the battlefield for days watching this man come up on the hill and taunt the whole Israel army and defy David's God. So that's where David drew the line. You might defile a lot of different people. When it comes to Israel and God's chosen people, when it comes to my God, that's where the line is drawn. See, David gets there, and he's standing there, and he walks up, and his brother even kind of puts him down. "You're only here for yourself. You're only here to see the battle." But David said, he heard this man come out. Now, I started to think, when David's standing there, a shepherd boy, had come on this day for, he wasn't even there for the army. He didn't come suited up. He didn't bring a sword. He didn't bring none of that. He was just being David. He was just being the shepherd boy, doing what he was told. He shows up on the battlefield that day with the whole Israel army. This man comes out with the same thing he's done for several days now and starts taunting the Israelites. I couldn't help but think that maybe when David heard the voice of Goliath, he felt God say, "This is it. This is what you were ordained for. This is what you were anointed for. This is why you were chosen above all your brothers." But what makes David so special? He's the smallest. It goes back to being a shepherd boy. The sling and the stone. The sling and the stone. That's what we like to think took Goliath down. But you see, the God that was behind David directed the stone. I believe when God was creating the earth, he made a little pebble and he dropped it. So that's gonna be for David. You see, everything like today was ordained and lined up for what God had planned. It's the same thing in our lives. If we're willing to look at it and see what God is doing in our lives and where He's taking us. But he also picked up four other stones. Four of them turned out to be useless, though. Well,
kind of butcher this.
Anyways, that's a sheep. See, this is what David was accustomed to. This was who he grew up protecting. This was his life. He was asked David. And that was probably, he might consider them more, the sheep more family. And his own brothers. I mean, he was left out in the field. They didn't, forgotten. He had to be asked about before he even remembered. Oh yeah, we got one more. You see, he said, one stone took down Goliath. Because of a shepherd boy, he picked it up. Because of a shepherd boy who was anointed. Because of a shepherd boy who had a heart after God's in his heart.
Amen. Amen.
See, there's no doubt God gave David courage to stand before Goliath. But if you read on, when David starts to have a conversation with Saul about going out on the battlefield, David says simply, "I'm a shepherd boy. A bear, a lion, it's just an enemy." And that's how he seen Goliath that day. He didn't see Goliath as the big bad warrior that everybody else was shivering from. David seen Goliath as the enemy that he was going to protect the flock from.
Yeah.
What he had done his whole life.
Yeah.
See, we can say that God can't use me. We can say that where I'm at in my life, what I've been raised at, whatever I've gone through in my life, God can't use that. But don't you think all his brothers thought the same thing about David?
Yeah.
That's why he wasn't even brought out of the field. But see, when David was brought out and he was anointed,
I can only imagine the power he felt and that anointing when he seen David and when Goliath walked out there. He's just nothing but another enemy. He simply said to Saul, when the enemy, paraphrasing, the enemy has the lion and the bears, comes and takes a lamb or a goat, I go after it. If it turns on me, I grab it by the jaw and I club it to death. So where does all this line up? How does all this turn into a sermon? I've said some pretty good things, I hope, but what does it point to? Where is it leading? One last what is that? See, David didn't know it either, that because he was brave enough, because he was a shepherd boy, that he was going to take down Goliath. And because he took down Goliath, he's going to become king. He's going to be crowned. See, David didn't care about that. He cared about a crown, but it wasn't the one that was going on his head. He was worried about the crown of eternal life. The crown of worshiping his God. The prize at the end of our journey here on earth. I overheard it while I was kind of a part of a conversation at work. And they were talking about a book that had been turned into a movie. And they were talking about, it was a family. They had, I don't know all the details. But anyway, the point of it is that they drank some kind of water or something, they would live forever. Some of you may know what I'm talking about. And they said, well, I wouldn't drink it. I wouldn't want to live forever. Thought popped in my head. I hate to say it, but I kept my mouth shut. Because whether you want to or not, you're going to live forever. Whether you want to or not, you may think you may take your last breath here on earth, but you're going to live forever. Yes. You're going to be in eternity. Yes. But you have a choice. David made his choice all throughout his life, not for a king over the Israelites, but a king before God. Right. Be crowned for God. Amen. You start to think about all this. I started to see Jesus. We as the flock, we as lambs, as goats. When the enemy comes for us, what does Jesus do for us? He takes us from the mouth of the enemy, puts his hand in his jaw, reminds him and puts him in his place. A king, a real, live, living king, we'll all face in eternity. As we close, I want to ask you today, do you feel chosen? You feel like David? Everybody else around you is much better fit for what you think God has in store? God's just asking you to be obedient. Right. He's not asking you to be head and shoulders above your brothers and your sisters, above your church. You don't have to stand out. You don't have to wear fancy clothes. You don't have to have a nice car. You don't have to have the biggest house on the block. You don't have to have the highest paying job. Yes. You do have to have one thing though. You got to be willing to search for one of these. To search for the crown of eternity. I'm not not talking about a physical crown. I'm talking about the crown that is above everything. Maybe you felt like this week or in your life that you're in the mouth of the enemy. He's got his grip on you. But that's all. Going up in church, we often hear the enemy's got a grip on people. He's in his mouth and he's trying to kill them. If you don't let him, if you don't let Jesus come in to save you, you will die in the mouth of the enemy. So I ask you today, in your obedience, in your life, right now, right in your, and in your future, as a body of Christ, are you willing to recognize your abilities?
Yes, come on.
Because whatever you've been going through in your life, God can use it.
Yes.
A shepherd boy, made to kill a giant. But he didn't see it when he was out in the fields. He thought, he was appalled that they would even think that he couldn't do it. Are you crazy? It's nothing but an enemy. I've seen a lot of people up here for prayer today. Being obedient. We may not be chosen to be a king over a nation, but we are chosen to be followers of a God who sent His Son, Jesus, to take us from the mouth of the enemy. He says, just go back to the flock, I got this. He was beaten, crucified, tormented. Not only physically, they were making fun of him while he was hanging on the cross. So if you find yourself saying, I know God's chosen me, but I don't see how I fit into the picture of what He has in store. It's a lie. David could have let his brothers tell him you're too small. Go back home, because they did. You're unworthy. You ever felt that before?
Yes.
I have. Still feel like sometimes. We don't have to be worthy. It's not a thing that we can do. It's not an action that we can do. About being faithful.
Yes, sir.
Are you going to be faithful today, tomorrow, rest of your life? We're not promised tomorrow. We're not promised to make it home. I'm not promised to finish the sermon. We often don't think about that until it actually happens to somebody. So I'm asking you to be honest to yourself and before God. Are you being obedient? Are you saying, yes, God? It's difficult. It's not easy. Like I said, you just got to say, okay.
Yes,
take it from the mouth of the enemy.
Yes.
It's that simple. The altars are open.
Amen.
Come.
Amen.
Weary, broken heart.
Yes.
It's for you. He didn't just do it for David. He did it for me.
Yeah.
But he also did it for all of Israel. It wasn't just about David. What God wants to do in your life isn't just for you. What God did in your life isn't just for you. It's for your family.
your coworkers, to your friends, for all those that don't want to live forever. The call isn't just for the shepherd boy. It's for every sheep. We're all offered to eternity. With him. He saved from the enemy.